Namaste. I'm Dr. Bijal Dodia, a critical care physiotherapist and a certified pelvic floor physical therapist. I work as a senior consultant and head of the unit of inpatient and critical care rehabilitation at Sir H.N. Reliance Foundation Hospital. I'm excited to discuss a case study focusing on early mobilization and its benefits in a critically ill patient. Why is it important to mobilize a patient who is already critically ill? Let us spend a couple of minutes understanding this. Globally, people recover from critical illness and get discharged from ICU. However, it has been noticed that patients develop weakness, probably credited to their prolonged period of immobilization. Post-intensive care syndrome was the term used that describes the worsening of physical, mental, and cognitive problems. Research suggests that early mobilization of critically ill patients is a safe option with additional benefits of improving functional outcomes. Prolonged periods of immobility have often been associated with physical deconditioning, fatigue, loss of function, and decreased quality of life have also been observed. We shall be discussing a case of a 43-year-old male presented to our ER with the symptoms like altered mental status, breathlessness, shivering, cough, and was febrile since a week. He was diagnosed to have community-acquired pneumonia, and on further investigations, it was discovered that he was slipping into sepsis. To protect his airways, it was put on mechanical ventilation and antibiotics. He was on PRVC mode of ventilator with 60% FiO2, 8 PEEP, with which he maintained his vitals within normal limits. He was also put on inotropic supports to maintain his blood pressure. He was then shifted to ICU for further care, and rehab call was given after 4 days for pulmonary hygiene and gradual progressive mobilization. He received chest physiotherapy and in-bed mobility exercises. On examination, he was found to have limb muscle weakness and was unable to perform transfers on his own. He needed support even to sit up in the bed. The rehab sessions also included neuromuscular electrical stimulation for diaphragm and all four extremities. This inclusion was to manage the ICU-acquired weakness which he had developed due to his critical condition and initial few days of immobilization. We encouraged him to sit at the edge of the bed but encountered episodes of hypotension which further restricted his mobility and increase his inotropic supports. Unfortunately, he developed acute kidney injury and had to be started on dialysis. He also started developing bed sores. The rehab sessions, however, continued along with electrical stimulation. After discussing with the multidisciplinary team, we began to start making him sit under the supervision of an intensivist who helped maintain the vitals within normal limits. A multidisciplinary team was formed to look after his mobilization. The team included the intensivist, physical therapist, nursing team, a patient care assistant, and a nursing AD. Our assessment included the following: detailed chart assessment, review of the ventilator settings and vital signs. Apart from the ventilator parameters mentioned before, we also looked for the tidal volume and the breathing efforts by the patient. Pain assessment was he had mild, dull, aching, generalized pain all over the body with pain intensity being 2 on 10 on numerical pain rating scale. It had no aggravating factors, and pain assessment was done at each session as pain being the fifth vital sign carried an important spot in evaluation. On auscultation, air entry was bilaterally decreased in middle and lower zones. Crepitations were present scattered bilaterally. There was no usage of accessory muscles and sensations were normal as reported by the patient. Limb girth measurement showed us that right lower limb measured 2 cm more than the left lower limb, and on MMT, bilateral lower limb were 3 out of 5 and bilateral upper limb was 4 out of 5 within the restrictions of lines and tubes. His reflexes were normal, and on functional independence examination, he was dependent for all activities and physical performance mobility could not be assessed due to his bedriddenness. treatment included chest physiotherapy, in-bed limb mobility exercises, breathing retraining, neuromuscular electrical stimulation, and with the multidisciplinary team effort, he gradually started showing progress in mobilization. Mobility began with the usual in-bed limb mobility exercises, progressing to sitting at the edge of the bed for 30 to 45 minutes. We generally make the patient sit and leave to attend other patients. We actually made a good usage of this opportunity when the patient was seated. Patient was given functional activities including playing video games and practicing recreational rehabilitation. A hoist was used to make him sit on chair, but this lasted only for 2 days as we were more interested in active mobilization with the patient's efforts. Gradual progressive mobility included working on his trunk control, making him stand initially on the tilt table and then with walker support, and then sit on the bedside chair followed by walking and gradually in subsequent sessions. Patient was discharged out of ICU on day 17 and continued the rehab in wards, which included enrollment in escalated rehab setting. Electrical stimulation was eventually stopped after 5 days in wards. Vigorous strengthening and endurance training exercises were started along with gradual progressive mobilization and functional training. Patient got discharged after total 26 days of hospital stay. He is still continuing with his visits in rehab unit on outpatient basis, and he has been running marathons post 3 months of hospitalization.